the cold weather, it was crazy. So we're thankful that you could all reschedule and be here tonight. And then we're also just thankful you're all here tonight. So thank you. Can people hear me? Okay, we had a smaller group last time and I felt like it was okay to talk, but hopefully if you can't hear me, just let me know. So logistics, you should all have, you signed in, there's an agenda, which is basically this up here. There is a PowerPoint handout, and then there is a training 101 book, like this, from Mighty Brain. So you should all have that. Does anybody not have one of those? Yeah, what do you need?
I don't have it.
Any of that? Oh, this? Oh, you got it? Okay. Raise your hand, so just this, do you choose here? The other thing we'll be doing is we will be doing some work, and there's some paperwork on your table. The additional paperwork will go over either at break or at the end. That is to, and we'll talk about this in a little bit, that's sort of the safety procedures, so background checks, applications, and a covenant statement to participate. But we'll talk about that later. For the presentation, you just need your buddy training manual 101, your agenda, and and also, so I'm going to do, we're going to start out, this is our, what we're going to do tonight, we're going to do introductions. I know there's a big group, but it's just so nice to introduce each other and be able to meet each other. We'll talk a little bit about what is Buddy Break, we're going to be talking about working with siblings. Not only are kids with special needs invited to Buddy Break, but they're siblings, so we're going to talk a little bit, focus on siblings. We're going to go over some risk management policies and some safety issues related to Buddy Break. We're going to talk about basic disability etiquette. Some of you might not have worked with kids with special needs or within the special needs population. So we'll just do a little primer about some etiquette and working with special needs population. And then we're going to talk about working with VIPs. What are VIPs? That is what Buddy Break calls kids with special needs. Very important people, VIPs. So we'll talk a little bit about some tips and hints in working with kids that have special needs. And then questions and discussion and paperwork. Please interrupt us today. That is the reason. I mean, there is actually a video training we can show, but we didn't want to bring you all here and just push a play button. So we're here so that you can ask questions, so we can interrupt each other, we can share ideas and things like that. So please, we want this to be engaged and have a discussion piece to it. So introductions. There's four women that are coordinating Buddy Break. My name is Michelle Demery. I'm a professor at NIU in the psychology department. And I work with kids with special needs in my area of expertise at NIU. I'll let Andrea.
I'm Andrea Castor. I'm a pediatric occupational therapist.
I'm Judy Valentini. I'm here at Nashville and special
needs. I'm Michelle Frediani, and I help out with Masterpiece also.
A little bit before we introduce you guys, I'm going to just skip ahead here a couple slides and just talk about Masterpiece Ministry, because we've already talked about that a little bit, and then we'll go to introductions. All four of us work in the Masterpiece Ministry here at First Baptist, and so some of you might not know this, some of you might, but we have a special needs ministry program here. And so it's been a program that we've been trying to grow over the last quite a few years. I think Andrea and I have been co-coordinating for about 6 years, but we've been trying to grow it. And one of the things we talked about with growing was to provide respite care for families that need respite care in the community. And so that's one of the reasons behind starting Buddy Break. It's something we've been wanting to do for a long time. But just so that you're aware, when we talk about Masterpiece Ministry, that's our special needs program that is part of First Baptist. And we'll talk a little bit about that as we go through the training. So those of you just coming in, there's some sheets to sign in over there, and then there are three handouts that I hope we're not out of. There is an agenda
that are associated with Buddy Break through Nathaniel's Hope due monthly. Well, when we first started, the church kind of said, well, let's see if you get any interest or any volunteers before you commit to doing it monthly. So the first thing we did was we prayed for volunteers, and here are our second training, so I think that's good news. I think we have the volunteers. Then after we saw we had a lot of volunteers, then we started training or praying for VIPs, because it's this, this is a balance, and just the last few weeks, we've had a lot of kids from the community sign up that we aren't familiar with, some new families. So God is working, and we're excited that you're all here. So I'm going to define a little bit about what Buddy Break is, and then I'm going to turn it over to Jamie, and she's going to talk about the day, what the day is going to look like. But a little bit about Buddy Break. We also are having some computer problems, so I'm not going to be showing this video clip to you that we have the link at the bottom. But basically, it's a free respite care program. We've been wanting to do respite care for a while, but we were worried because there's a lot of logistics. There's a lot of safety things, there's a lot of logistics, training, and all of that. And so we ended up finding out about a program called Nathaniel's Hope, which is out of Florida. It's a church in Florida, which actually the founder of it had a son that had special needs. And so she, who passed away, actually. And so, but as they were caring for him, she really realized this need for families to have respite care. And so she started this, and it basically provides this sort of foundation and this training and a system for us to implement Buddy Break at different churches. And so there's other churches in Illinois that are implementing Buddy Break. And so the nice thing for families is they can go on and see if another church. I know, for example, when we got trained in Buddy Break, we all got trained at, I forget what church in Wheaton, Pope Church, I forget the name of the church in Wheaton that we got trained at. So that church also might be starting a Buddy Break. So then families can go to different churches. We would coordinate. If our Buddy Break is the first Saturday of every month, it might be the second Saturday of every month in Wheaton. So anyway, that was how we got started with this program, Buddy Break, was we knew we wanted to start a program, and we were looking for one, and we got trained by Nathaniel's Hope Buddy Break. So what they do is they talk about kids with special needs. Again, they call kids with special needs VIPs. So throughout the night, you're going to hear us talk about VIPs, and that is kids with special needs. And then those that are serving with VIPs are called buddies. And so most of you will end up being buddies, and we'll talk about that in a little bit. So those are the volunteers that work with Buddy Break. Okay, so I've talked about this. We're hoping, one of our goals is we're hoping that by reaching out to the community a lot as those families come to Buddy Break and get respite care, they don't have to be affiliated with our church to get that respite care, although some are. We know, you know, we have some families here that are already affiliated with the church. But our goal is to let them know about us and let them know about our Sunday school program as well and our church. So maybe some of the families will come back and choose to come to church, or they, of course, don't have to, but that is another goal of ours. So what might a day at Buddy Break look like? I'm going to turn it over to Jamie, and she's going to talk a little bit about what Buddy Break is going to look like, the first one, which she's been planning.
Perfect. So Buddy Break, February 15th, our VIPs will be showing up at 10, but we need all of you guys to show up at 9, an hour early. And in that hour before they get here, 45 minutes before they get here, we'll just be discussing, if you are a buddy, to a VIP, we'll be discussing some minor details that you need to know, last minute questions that you might have. And again, we'll be going around the church just letting you know exactly what's happening throughout the church, know what activities are happening, what classroom, and again, any last minute questions that you guys might have. We're also going to have donuts and coffee. So make sure you guys are nice and ready to go. At 9:45, we're asking all the parents, the VIPs, to come a little early. There's a few things, some paperwork that they need to have notarized and prepared for the day. So we're asking them to arrive at 9:45. So if you do have a VIP, we'll have you at the door ready for them. So we're all smiling and, again, something pleasant that they're walking into. From 10 to 10:30, we are having music time downstairs. And again, we have three or four songs. We have music, some signs that go along with songs. And we're going to be in here just having a really great time introducing the kids to the day and just kind of like a mingle kind of time to kind of help out. During that music time, and I should explain something before we get started. So we kind of have three areas of volunteers. We have a VIP buddy. We have a buddy to a sibling. And then we have what we're calling activity helpers. Throughout the day, we have lots of activities in different classrooms here at church. And we need people obviously in there to make sure that there's no chaos or everything is going nice and smooth. And I'll get into that in just a second. So my activity helpers, in that half an hour, just be in their classroom, making sure that everything's set up, and again, ready for the students as they walk in. From 10:35 to 10:15, we're having what we call activity time. So the church is just kind of open to kind of wander with your VIP or sibling as you please. So there's no structure. It's not like you're going to be in one classroom for maybe 15 or 20 minutes. It's kind of like just as your VIP is kind of feeling or your sibling's feeling. So you might stay in one room for a half an hour. You might stay in one room for 5 minutes. And you might not go in any of some of the other classrooms. And I'll get to that in just a second. At 12:20 and 12:30, we're going to have lunch upstairs in the gym, and we'll have a video, we'll have some pictures that we've been taking throughout the day, displaying for the kids to see. And then parents will be here at 1 o'clock to pick their kids up. So our activities. Here are the activities that we have throughout the day. And the places that they're going to be taking place. Our room numbers aren't exact right now, but it's kind of just to give you an idea. We'll have the gym open. We will not have a bouncy house. But we'll have a lot of balls up there to play, basketball games going on, relay races. Just a lot of activities for our kids who are very physical and want to run around and just kind of get some of that energy out. We'll have a room with, our theme is Valentine's Day, since it's a day after Valentine's Day. So we have 3 to 4 crafts, and all of our crafts kind of range on age and ability. So we have something really easy as, you know, laying some tissue paper on a heart to something a lot more difficult for some of our higher functioning, you know, kids or siblings who kind of want something more appropriate. So, and you'll know that, what you think is appropriate when you get into the classroom. Games galore, we just have a room filled with different games that the kids can play. We were lucky enough to get we're gonna have a room with therapy dogs. A therapeutic center in the community has offered to bring, I think, 3 dogs. And again, some of the kids will love it, and some of the kids will hate it. So you'll know that information prior to. But again, the dogs are going to be in one classroom. You can walk in, the kids can interact with the dog, the dogs, and just have fun. We'll have a sensory room. We'll have things like Play-Doh, sand table, shaving cream, things for kids who definitely need that sensory output throughout the day. We have a reading room. We'll have a person reading a few stories throughout the day for those who just want to sit and relax. We thought it would be fun for some of our siblings to have a Wee Wigglers room. We have 3 different Wees set up, and the kids can go in there. We're only playing interactive, like sport games, so we have Wii Sports or Wii Fit, things like that to keep the kids moving. And we'll have a music room. So again, throughout that activity time, 10:30 to 12:30, it's just kind of like you're just going to be wandering around the church, figuring, you know, you'll have a schedule and a map of where all these classrooms are located, but you don't have any time limit as far as what room you have to be in for a certain amount of time. So when we're done talking here, on the back tables there's some colored paper, and throughout the presentation, just start thinking about where you think you would want to volunteer. Do you want to be a buddy for a VIP? Do you want to be a buddy for a sibling? Or would you be more interested in being a crafter or helping out in the gym or something like that? We also just have floaters for people who maybe just want to float around, make sure that everything is nice and calm and that no one needs any assistance. But all of those jobs are on the back table, so we'll give you guys a break. You guys can kind of maybe get an idea about what would be best for you. And these are just other expectations if you're going to be an activity helper. When the children come in with the buddies, just to make sure that everything's set up, or if someone needs to take a bathroom break, that's our expectation is to be an activity helper and you're in that classroom, that you can keep an eye on the VIP while the buddy takes, has to take a break. Again, just making the proper supplies are there. If you're in the gym, you're going to make sure that, you know, the games are ready to go when the next group of people come in. And again, just making sure that everyone's really having a great time. And here are some other class or rooms that we'll have. We'll have a quiet room, because we definitely have a lot of kids who don't like the music or don't like the loud sound of all the stimulus going on. So we'll have a quiet room for those who just maybe need a 20-minute, 30-minute break just to kind of calm and do nothing. We'll have a change room. We do have some students who are going to have some toilet needs. You won't have to do that. We'll be taking care of that for you. And then we'll have a snack room. Some kids can't go the whole morning without snacks. So we don't want to have food throughout the church. So we'll have a room kind of designated that you have to come and bring your kid and have a quick little snack before you get on with your next activity. I think that's my last slide. Any questions about the day? Yes.
Maybe I missed it, but what's the age
range? We advertise this from birth to age 18. Right?
20.
So we have a wide range. Right now what we have enlisted, we definitely have
a 1-year-old. We have a 1-year-old and then we have a 17-year-old. So it's a wide age range.
Any more questions? And that was kind of sometimes like the difficulty coming up with activities for the day. How do you plan something for a one-year-old and then a 17-year-old? So a lot of the classrooms that you'll walk into, you know, the games are going to range from, you know, something that would be, you know, beneficial for a one-year-old, and things hopefully that will be suited for a 17-year-old, or at least their ability level.
But it's so, kind of the same for kids with special needs and without special needs. There's activities that should be fun for both.
Correct. Any questions?
Those are good questions.
Okay.
Are the crafts, those are already determined, you guys determine the crafts, and are the materials ready, or do you need helpers to get them ready?
Everything's ready. Luckily for Oriental Trade, everything came in a nice bag for us. So all the supplies will be out there, and I'll have like a leader in the craft room. As you guys volunteer, I'll have a leader just to, you know, I'll touch base with them and say, okay, here are the three crafts, this is what it's supposed to look like, here are the directions. And as activity helpers, you guys can just figure out what that will look like, you know, during that time. Yes?
There are a lot of kids, like, I know my kids have special dietary needs. Mm-hmm. So, for the snack room, are there going to be people who are going to have to be working with the kids to figure out what they can eat?
Yes. That? So, that's a great question. And for lunch, the kids are all bringing a set lunch. So, we don't have to really worry about any of the allergies or worry about that we're not giving the kids the right food. So, they're required to bring their set lunch. And if they're going to need a snack, we'll let parents know that they also should just bring their snack, just so that we don't have any, you know, be responsible for that.
And buddies will be bringing a sack lunch as well. We thought about providing lunch, but then we thought that seemed kind of strange to have them bring a sack lunch and feed you guys a fancy, you know, shared lunch. So everyone will be bringing lunch. That will be the lunches for you.
And no peanuts.
And no peanuts.
No peanuts.
No peanuts. Okay, so I wanted to, before we start talking about risk management issues and go over working with VIPs, which is what Andrea is going to mostly focus, I wanted to talk a little bit, just stress the importance of working with siblings. A lot of these families, the siblings sometimes feel like the child with special needs might be requiring a lot of attention, getting a lot of focus, maybe because not purposefully or intentionally, but they have special needs, so they might be getting lots of therapies and taking a lot of resources and family time. So one of the goals is really to make siblings also feel really special. And so I just wanted to highlight that because if you end up being a sibling, you know, a buddy to a sibling, that's still a really important role, is to be a buddy to that sibling and have that sibling spend the day with someone having a lot of fun and doing some great things and having a special time as well. So we just wanted to highlight that. Because not everyone's going to be able to be a buddy to a VIP. We're going to have siblings that are going to need buddies as well. We just wanted to highlight the important role that is. And also it's something to think about. We'll talk a little bit in a minute here about working with individuals with special needs, and we're going to ask people their preferences. We might not be able to give everybody their preference. If everybody wants to, you know, work with a sibling or everybody wants to work with a VIP, obviously that's not going to work. We'll have to make some of those decisions. But also on your comfort level, what you think you might be interested in might matter as well. But siblings are really important.
Will there be a way to identify siblings from the VIPs? Sometimes you can't tell.
Right. That's a very good point. We hadn't thought of that, but maybe we should. So if as you guys have these great ideas,
maybe we'll have a different color name tag.
Maybe a different color VIPs. Name tag.
Yeah.
Let's do that.
Maybe what you should do is if there's a sibling on that name tag and the VIP.
Put their VIP.
Put a number on there.
The VIP name tag says VIP.
Oh, it does?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah, but like if I want to find that.
Oh,
child
matching.
Sibling,
they're matching. Oh.
If you put numbers on them, then you know 21
idea.
Matches 21.
Right. That's a good idea.
So, yes, we will think about a way to match, and we'll make sure that you can differentiate the VIPs from the siblings. Okay, so I want to talk briefly about risk management policies. I'm not going to go through all of them in great detail. I'm going to highlight on the next few slides some more global things. What I do want to say, and this is, I didn't put these on PowerPoints. Almost everything in this little thing is on a PowerPoint, but this isn't. It's in your book on pages 4 and 5. One of the things I do want to just say outright is that we're taking this really seriously, and which is why we've been planning for quite a long time. Because bringing individuals from the community in with a wide variety of special needs, you know, you can't just do that without planning. And so We all attended a training from Buddy Breaks. I attended an extra training in working with kids with special needs, sort of restraint issues in case there was any, self-harm or anything like that. Their program has a lot of safety procedures built in, so there will be, we absolutely have a nurse signed up that day to be there that day on hand in case anything should happen. All of the families fill out a very extensive form that if you are a buddy to that child, you will get to see that form and we will go through that with you. So it talks about eating, any special issues with eating and behavior and all of that. Those are notarized for liability, and Michelle became a notary. She's our paperwork guru. She became a notary so we can notarize things for, so we're taking it really serious. The church is taking it really serious. And so I just wanted to kind of put that out there. There's some risk management policies here. We'll, of course, have emergency numbers and all of that. And that's why there's a training, is that, everyone has had a training and we're not, we're taking it seriously. So there are other issues on here, just confidentiality. When you get these forms that talk about the child, there's all kinds of sensitive information on there. So it's really important. You want to learn about your child, that you want to keep that information confidential. On an as-needed basis. As we're working that day with that child, we want to be able to communicate about them and their special needs, but it's really important. We're a small community, and you want to keep that confidential besides working with your child here at church. So this goes through some of that, but I'm going to highlight some of the really important things in the next couple slides. One thing is, everything's one-on-one. Every VIP will have one buddy, and every sibling will have one buddy. And so this way we know everybody's accounted for because you should always have your VIP with you or your sibling with you. We even talked about for some children we might have an adult VIP buddy and a youth. So you might have, as an adult buddy with a VIP, you might have a youth that's also assigned to you to kind of help you out. And so that's really important. You should never leave your VIP unattended. So if you need to use the restroom, asking for one of the floaters or something, and the reason for that is some kids sometimes run. We have, in our classroom, we have some runners. and you'll know if they're a runner, that's actually on the paperwork. It asks, how your child might respond to situations, and so we would warn you if your child might run. But you never know. Anyone could end up kind of taking off. And so if it's one-on-one, we know that everyone is always accounted for. So that's really important. Bathrooming and diapering. Some of these are older children and they are not toilet trained. And so we will help you. I don't want anyone to not volunteer because they're worried about toileting issues. There's safety procedures there. No one helps with a bathroom procedure on their own. There should always be two people. We will have a room designated for that and we will help you. So there's nothing to worry about there except knowing where the room is in case it should be needed. Obviously, some of this is just health and safety things and working with kids, washing hands. Some of the youth might put things in their mouth. And so you'll know that from your form if a child's more prone to put things in their mouth. But if you know that, then it's going to be to watch for that. If you're in the craft room, making sure they're not putting things they shouldn't put in their mouth. If it is a child that just likes to mouth things, we might have appropriate toys with you to give this child so that they can, chew on things in their mouth. We'll have, in each room, we'll have a bin for things that need to be washed. So if a child puts something in their mouth that, it belongs in the room and they're mouthing something just so that we can wash it and take care of those kinds of things. So we'll have that all set up, but mostly just safety. We want to make sure that children aren't putting things in their mouth that they shouldn't be doing. So I already mentioned there will be a nurse on premises. We'll have a way, the nurse will have the nurse housed in sort of a check-in area upstairs, so you'll always know where the nurse is available. The same for the coordinators. We're not gonna be buddies. We're just gonna be walking around, making sure things are going smoothly. We talked about getting walkie-talkies so we can find everybody if we need to touch base. Abuse issues, just like our church does with all kids, and especially for kids with special needs, everyone will, and we'll do this paperwork in a little bit, we'll talk about doing a background check. Anyone who works with children's ministries here has to undergo a background check, and then some other paperwork. Food, they're going to only be able to eat or drink what they bring. And again, we're going to talk to you, there's a whole section on the form about eating. I know I just talked to a family this week, and that child has some eating issue. So, so that would be something that you would know about, you'd know in advance what those issues are, how to deal with those issues, and we'll be there to support you as well. So, and then if there's any accidents or incidents, you know, which can happen with kids playing games in gyms and all that stuff, we have an incident form as well. So, but we're gonna be around that day, walking around. Questions on just, we'll still go over working with VIPs, but just safety issues? So I'm just gonna, before Andrea talks about specifically working with kids with special needs, I'm gonna talk just a little bit about some basic etiquette. So I know some of you mentioned when we went around the room, you haven't really worked with kids with special needs before, and that's great, it doesn't matter at all. We're glad you're here. But I thought sometimes it's helpful to have a little bit of background information. So I talked about confidentiality and the importance of confidentiality because you're going to be knowing stuff about these families, and so you just want to keep that in mind and being respectful about confidentiality. Another basic etiquette is people first language, it's called. When you talk about kids with special needs, it's always sort of best practice or etiquette to say the person before the disability. So an example would be, he's an autistic child. Would not be the best example. You'd want to say he is a child with autism. Because then you're not defining the child by their disability. He's an autistic child. People do this wrong all the time. But it's just kind of helpful to know as you think about working with families and think about working within special needs ministry or with families with kids with special needs. It gets wordy, just always say that. Kids with special needs as opposed to, you know, disabled children or special needs kids or something like that. Which is, I think, why the program probably calls them VIPs. Because you can easily say, oh, we have a group of VIPs coming. And it's a really positive statement. I don't have to say, oh, we have a group of kids with special needs coming. You know, that's really long and it's also kind of awkward. So it's really nice. I think that's really nice. So we can call the kids VIPs. They're very important people. And it makes it for an easy way to acknowledge and talk about the group. Acknowledge a person with special needs just like you would anyone else. And this can be hard because there might be kids that are nonverbal. And so you might be meeting mom and you might say like, oh, hi mom, I'm so glad to meet you. And you know your child doesn't talk. But you still want to acknowledge them even, and you don't have to expect an answer back. So you can say, you know, hi mom, I'm so glad to meet you. And Joey, I'm so glad to meet you today. Even though Joey might not be able to talk. And so it's still important, you don't want to only talk to mom and not acknowledge the child with special needs. And sometimes that's easy to feel awkward because you know they can't talk. And so you think, well, I don't want to say something to them because they're not going to talk back. But that's okay. Just acknowledge, I'm so glad to see you, Joey. It's great you're here today. And knowing that Joey might not talk back, but you might get a great big smile or something like that. Joey. So that's a little bit related to this. Just because someone cannot talk does not mean they do not understand what you're saying, or they don't want someone to talk to them. So can you know, 3 hours is a long time. So if you think about spending 3 hours with a child with special needs that doesn't talk, you don't want to not talk for 3 hours. So you have to think about just sort of talking to the child, knowing they're not going to talk back. So Joey, I'm thinking maybe those balls look like fun over there. Maybe let's go, I'm gonna push you over there, let's go look at those balls. So you can kind of narrate what you're doing. So then you go over, you bring, you know, go to play with some balls, you look at Joey. Joey, it looks like you're having fun. Should we try something else? It's okay to sort of talk, ask a rhetorical question, comment on what you're doing. And Andrea will talk a little bit about how Joey, if he is nonverbal, how he might communicate back to you without language. By pointing, by smiling, by making some choices with pictures and things like that. So we'll talk about that, but just kind of some of that broad etiquette. Think about that if you are assigned a child that is nonverbal. Try to ask before providing assistance. If you think that the child with special needs might need help, it's still polite to sort of ask if you want some help with coloring mats before you just start helping them. So just a polite way to provide assistance. Use the same tone of voice, choice of words, and nonverbal language as you would with a person without special needs. So if we have a boy in our classroom who's tall, he's so tall, and he's like 17 years old, almost nonverbal, so you wouldn't want to talk to him. He's a big kid, so you wouldn't want to talk to him like he's a little baby. even though he's nonverbal. So, hey, how are you doing today? How was your weekend? It's fine. Talking to him just like he's a 16-year-old, as opposed to talking to him in, you know, a baby voice or something like that. So just thinking about still treating them somewhat age-appropriately. Using the word with, not for, demonstrates joining. So I'm going to color with you instead of for you. It's kind of a nice way to join with them if they're needing help on activities, or I'm going to do this with you as opposed to for. Positive words. Some words have negative connotations. The examples up here are things like saying the words crippled or wheelchair bound. Those just have sort of negative connotations, emphasizing what people can't do. So thinking about the language we're using. Wheelchairs, be respectful of wheelchairs. Think of it actually as an extension of their body. And so you want to maybe let them know before you're going to push them somewhere. Talking to them about that or asking permission if they're verbal. Not leaning on the wheelchair or something like that. Really thinking of it as their personal space. Remember, some disabilities are not observable. And we have some kids like that in our classroom, and we'll have new teachers, and they'll think, well, I don't really see why that child's in this room. But eventually, they, non-observable behavior, they have special needs. And so eventually, that becomes apparent. Provide acceptance, not pity. Treat them as, you know, we do all kids and everyone in our church with dignity, respect, and common courtesy. My favorite theme of our children's ministry is love children to Jesus. And so that's all we're going to do, the same thing. We're just going to love children with special needs to Jesus. And then don't be afraid to make mistakes. This is a big long list of, you know, and I worry that you're, you know, people are going to be thinking, oh my gosh, I'm going to say something wrong or do something wrong. It doesn't matter. This is to provide you a little bit of that foundational knowledge, but don't be afraid to make mistakes. If you do, you're just going to apologize and love the child to Jesus. So just some background as we think about working with kids with special needs. Questions about some of this? Okay, well then, is that Andrea, are you next? So Andrea's going to talk about working with your VIP. Okay. Well, how are we doing on time? We're doing pretty good. So I think we have in the agenda a break. We could take a break, or we could just keep going and be done when we're done. Okay, I'm seeing shaking for let's just keep going and be done when we're done. Okay,
so when the moms and dads come in with the kids, we are going to be very happy and greet the kids. But let me back up first. When we figure out through your preferences if you're going to want a child, a sibling, or if you're going to want a VIP, we are going to, either at the end of the week or next week, contact you to let you know a little bit background information about the VIP kids. There is an extensive list of forms that the parents will be filling out that have any kind of medical concerns, their communication abilities, things that they like, things that they don't like, so we will be going over those with you. And then also, we're going to be using that time from 9 to 9:45. You can kind of go over information in the forms that we're going to let them have.
Yeah,
you got with. If you have a VIP child, there's going to be a pertinent information that you can have with you. You know, I was also thinking it might be helpful just to kind of have siblings' names on there. If they have a pet, what their pet's name is, that might be something to kind of communicate a little bit with the child. It's always like a nice topic just to kind of get them to converse a little bit. And even if they can't talk, just so they know, they will more than likely know their sibling's name or their pet, and that might get a nice reaction from them. So you're going to know who you're going to have. You're going to know the name of the child. So we're going to help you with that process of recognizing who it is coming in, and you will greet them happily. You'll ask mom or dad, oh, how is Joey doing today? And hi, Joey, how you doing? We just don't want to overwhelm the kids at first. More than likely, they probably are going to be a little bit like, this is going to be something very new for them. And it might be a little bit apprehensive at first. And what I found is just to kind of use a nice calming voice and not too overwhelming, just to kind of make them feel comfortable. We're going to let the parents know that we've read the information about their child, so we know the basics. We're going to try not to ask too many private, personal medical questions in the greeting process. So just be respectful of that. Because we're going to have the therapy dogs in a room, some kids love dogs. There's going to be a couple I know in our classroom. There's a boy that really does not like dogs. So that'll be something to know. Like, we know that we're not going to bring Joe into the therapy dog room because that's not going to go over well. So that'll be something to know. And then any like basic information of, you know, just, oh, what do they really like to play with? That might be something to ask, and just to kind of have in the back of your mind, like, oh, okay, well, if music doesn't seem to be their thing in the music room, then, oh, they love balls. So we can just kind of go back to that ball activity, things like that. So you're going to gather up all their belongings and their lunches, and we're going to have a designated spot to put those in. Okay, so interacting with the VIPs, we have, just in our classroom alone, we've got children that have physical disabilities that are in wheelchairs, where it's pretty obvious that the disability is that they are unable to move around and walk. We've got children that have cognitive disabilities that are just delayed and may just present like a younger child. We've got kids that have emotional disabilities that sometimes these are the kids that they're in classrooms and it kind of looks like, well, there's nothing wrong with this girl and why is she in here? But they might just act like a very, even though they're verbal and they can communicate, they just maybe are going to emotionally act a lot younger and maybe not be able to participate in some activities that a 14-year-old child would like. And so that's something to kind of be aware of, that even though they look very typical and it seems like they're able to participate in activities, that might be one thing. And then another thing is hidden disabilities. Some children that have significant ADD, ADHD, it's going to be another one of those kids that they kind of look okay, and it might not necessarily be that they're misbehaving or they're just, you know, being bratty, but there is oftentimes a very significant problem there that is really goes beyond the scope of behavior, and this can be exhausting for a parent too, and you know, that I know I've talked to moms that are in stores that get nasty looks from other moms, like, oh, you can't control your kid, and you know, oftentimes it's one of these things that you can't see, and there's reasons for that, and so these kids need as much love from us and their parents too. So, and then the other big disorder that is very prevalent nowadays is autism. So we have kids that will be in the program that have autism, and there's a big spectrum with that. You have very, very high functioning children that might have something called Asperger's disorder that are very verbal and very, very, very intelligent. We've had kids in this program that some of the conversations and the questions that they would ask me, I didn't even know what they were talking about. Like, woo, right over my head. So that's nice. However, with these kids, there's always a social piece that's missing. And although they can communicate and although they're verbal, the ability to socialize and interact with other children is really, really the problem. Oftentimes they can interact very good with adults, but being able to have friends, being able to kind of fit in, and even just physically and emotionally feeling secure around other kids, it's very difficult for these kids. And that is, like I said, that is such a huge problem nowadays, that there's so many kids that are on the spectrum. And then you've got the other end of the spectrum, where you've got children that have autism that are very low functioning, that are not, there are teenagers and they're not even potty trained, and are teenagers that only have about 5 words in their repertoire of words. So the thing to keep in mind with that, we were going to be playing a video clip about what it's like for a person that has autism. And it's too bad that we can't play it, because it was very interesting. But basically, the video clip is this boy that's just, you know, in a normal everyday situation, just kind of walking down the street that you and I do every day. But to him, it was just like the cars and the horns and the people around, and the poor kid is kind of just like this the whole time, and oh, I can't take this. And they show he's in a restaurant and somebody like stirring the coffee, and the lights that were just like, oh my gosh, I can't take this. And he kind of just like held it in until at the end of the day he just kind of had a meltdown. And that is a very, very common thing with not all kids. The interesting thing about autism is that there's a couple little things that are similar in a lot of kids, but it's not always the same. There's going to be kids that are very sensitive to too much noise. We've got a boy in our room who loves music, who loves to hear music on a CD, but does not like to hear people singing. So like kind of live people singing. So it really, some of this information we will know based on how mom and dad fill it out, and you'll know that. You'll know like, oh, this child really doesn't like music, or this child really doesn't like to hear babies cry, things like that. So it's just, it just makes me sad, because these kids that are so overwhelmed with all this environmental stimuli sometimes don't have the words to be able to say that. The buzzing of that light is driving me crazy. Because there's so many people around me, it's too much, and you know, this sweater on my skin is like, you know, it's like scratching me, and they can't say that. And oftentimes it's that's when we'll see, like, oh, they might be having a little bit of a meltdown, or they might just kind of sit on the floor and kind of taking a timeout. The other thing that always breaks my heart is sometimes there's kids that are upset. You can see that they're upset, and sometimes there's tears, and it's like we don't know what's wrong with them because they can't tell us. So it's kind of heartbreaking, but there are ways that we use in our classroom, and that I've used in just my being a therapist of working with kids. And you know, we have got little pictures where, you know, we can say like, oh, do you want a snack, or do you want a bathroom? Like little pictures that basically replicate things in their life that they like. So if we have a child that is nonverbal, that does very well with these pictures, we're going to ask mom, you know what, can you bring these pictures in for us to use during this buddy break time? And we have some of these pictures in our classroom too that we can kind of use, and we're going to know the kids that are not verbal that we can kind of use these with. And then another thing is just basic signs. Some of these kids know basic signs. More and all done is such a great thing. For a child that can't communicate, just knowing the signs for more or all done is great. If they seem like they're upset, like we're going to be moving them out to a different room, and if they seem like they're going to be upset, you could just say, oh, do you want more? And oftentimes you'll know. You'll see a happy expression, or they might grab the object that you were playing with. They want more, or all done. Most of the kids in our class have the ability to know that, to know, you know, do they want this, do they want that? So that's good to know. Any question about the disabilities? That was our slide. Okay, so what we're going to try to be doing is we're going to want all these kids to participate as best that they can. So if we have a child in a wheelchair and the other kids are playing kickball in the gym, then we can just take the ball and kind of get down their level and throw the ball or give them the ball and have, you know, put our arms out like this to make a basket or get a little box for them to throw in. Just adapting is just such a great thing. Like it doesn't have to be this complicated process of, oh, we're gonna try to make this activity. Just a simple activity that they can participate with the group. If they're doing a game that has, like, the kids are dancing around, well, then we'll move the wheelchair around and they're gonna be dancing with the kids, things like that. And just be creative. And I like to always just give kids a choice. If there's two different activities in the room, then you can just, like, hold up the ball or hold up, what else can we have?
Hula hoop.
A hula hoop. And, oh, do you want to play with the hula hoop or the ball? And they'll be able to let you know. They really will. So just giving them kind of a choice in what they want to do. We're going to have the pictures. And then the other thing I was going to say, the people that are in, the volunteers that are in the room, I think that's a very important job, because even though you've worked with children or you've even worked with children with special needs, sometimes it takes another person to like help initiate with something. Oh, you see the gym volunteer person can see a buddy and a VIP kind of not really knowing what to do, and it'll be kind of up to you to suggest different activities and kind of help them and guide them along. And we're going to have lots of toys. We're going to have lots of toys, lots of games in the area, in the room, so there will be lots of different choices to do with the kids. So the kids that are not going to be able to communicate with you, we're just going to be very sensitive to kind of watching their nonverbal language and when they're smiling and when they're laughing, and let's just, you know, kind of continue on with the activity. We're not going to be, I just don't want you to think, oh, well, there's so many different rooms and you didn't even make it to these three rooms. It's okay. If they want to be in the room with the therapy dogs for 45 minutes and they're happy, let them be in the room with the therapy dogs. However, I would say to try to help initiate things with the child. If you're going to like go to the next room, I would kind of like give them a little heads up. Like in five more minutes, we're gonna go read a story. In three more minutes, we're gonna go read a story, because sometimes transitions are very difficult. We oftentimes will get kids that will just kind of lay on the floor and I'm not going. And we want this to be fun for them. We don't want this to be a stressful time. If they want to lay on the floor, then let's adapt an activity on the floor. Let's do bowling. You know, we can set up the bowling pins and they could roll their ball. But I would say, like, I would try to encourage them and offer them what's in the next room. And you know, maybe that could even be like a picture of a dog that, so they know that in the next room there's dogs, or pictures of books that, you know, we can go read a book. So just being able to initiate and encouraging, like gently encouraging them to try the different activities. And then we do have kids that will, if they want something, they know what they want, even though they can't say it. So they will kind of like grab your shirt or your arm over to what they want. We've got kids that if they want a snack, they will like try to find their bag in the classroom, or they will grab a little picture icon of a snack and grab the picture up and give it to you, or just if they see something, they'll just kind of pull you over there. So just different ways that kids can communicate, gazing at things. Okay, so we are going to, I kind of talked about just kind of being flexible. We're going to be flexible in letting them experience and do what they want, but also just in in communicating with them and just responding to how they're behaving. And I can guarantee that there are definitely going to be meltdowns. So I don't want anybody to feel bad about that or anybody to be shocked. I mean, I would be completely shocked if there are not at least 5 meltdowns. I mean, we have, I'd say like at least, you know, in our Sunday school classroom, I'd say, you know, at least 2 of the Sundays a month, there's some kind of meltdown over something. So it's par for the course, and we are going to be there to help you. We don't want you to feel like, oh my gosh, I don't know what to do. The 4 of us, we talked about like having like matching scarves, so we'll kind of stand out. And another job we're going to have is a runner that's going to be kind of going to the different rooms and checking in. So if you see her, you could say, oh, I need help with Kelly. She's laying on the floor and she looks upset. So we're always going to be there to help you. If somebody gets hurt, so not only are we going to be walking around, but you're going to know, like, you're going to know the people that you can kind of turn to when you need help. So I always like to be, I try not to be too obnoxious, but I definitely like exaggerate my expressions with kids, and I try not to be too loud, but I'd say 95% of the kids that I work with, they like to see happy and smiley faces, not necessarily too loud, but happy and smiley and kind of getting down to their level and talking to them. And then yes, anytime that they do something, any kind of successful activity, when they participate, just praise them. Oh, you did such a great job. Even if they smile or react to you in a little way. Oh, that's so great. You like this, Joey. Oh, maybe we should do it again. So positive support. This is kind of what I was talking about transitions. So transitions are hard. So that's one thing. Like if it's going to be lunchtime, we're going to kind of tell them that, you know, in 5 more minutes, we're going to have lunch. Most of the kids are going to be okay with this, but there definitely are going to be kids that are going to have trouble like leaving what they're doing and going to the next room or the next activity. But that's another time where you can kind of use choices. Oh, do you want to keep playing with the ball, or do you want to go listen to music? Just to kind of use to help them. When we have kids that are getting stressed and getting upset, we obviously will have you stop the activity that they're doing. If you found earlier that they really seem to like throwing the ball or catching the ball, then that can kind of be something that you carry along with you just as a backup and try to offer that. That we're going to have a quiet room because, like I said, there are going to be kids that are going to get upset and just, it might be one of these kids that just get too overwhelmed. There's just way too many people in this room. It's too noisy. I just need a break and I need to be by myself. So that room will be available. And again, there's going to be somebody in that room to help. So I just don't want you to feel like, well, what do I do? We are going to be helping you every step. Managing difficult behavior, I kind of talked about that, but just always just praising and redirecting things that they're doing. It's fine to tell them to, when they're doing something that they shouldn't be doing, then no, you have nice hands and use nice words and things like that. So when somebody has a significant meltdown, as Michelle said, she is trained in restraints, and hopefully we won't have to do anything like that. But we're going to be there. We're going to be there to help, and we're going to be in that room. And so I just don't want to focus too much on this, because we will be there for you. You're not going to have to do any of this stuff by yourself, nor will you have to change diapers. So. What I wanted to say before this is there's going to be kids that are going to, it's going to be very apparent they're going to love this. They're going to have the best time. They're going to be saying, oh, this is great. And I'm talking about the VIPs. They're going to have a great time, and you're going to get the appreciation of reciprocity and communication and joy, but there's also going to be kids that really don't know how to do that don't know how to give you a hug, or that don't know how to really have that interaction. So I don't want anybody to take that personally. What you have to keep in mind is that by you guys doing this for these parents and giving them these 3 hours to themselves, and for them knowing that their kids are safe and being entertained, that's like a huge gift to them. So, you know, Michelle and I would always say, like, when we started the program, we sometimes would feel bad, because it's like it was just her and I, and sometimes we had like 6 and 8 kids at one time, and it was like pure chaos in the room, and it's like, oh my gosh, we wanted to do a Bible story, and we wanted to do all these structured activities, and we couldn't. It was just like chaos, and we actually would leave feeling guilty. We would go home thinking, what did we really do for these kids? Did we really help them? But the more we talked about it, it's like, no, we really did, because we were exhausted after an hour and 15 minutes with these kids. Like, we would go, how do these parents do this day in and day out without getting a break? So the fact that they now get to go to church, and they can, you know, even take a few minutes after church to talk to people and socialize is like gift enough, really. And the extra benefit is that the kids are going to get something from this. Every kid, even though she might not be able to communicate it, they're going to enjoy pieces of this day immensely. So I just want you to keep that in mind. And then when moms and dads come to pick up the kids, we were talking about having a little kind of card of things that they did, things that they really liked that you can kind of share with their child. When we did this training last time, I gave an example of a story. I don't know if anybody of you were in the church when they had the kids kind of marched through the aisles to like give their donations. They kind of walked across the stage. And so we brought our Masterpiece Ministry kids up there to do that. And there was one little girl who said that she wanted to go. We were kind of like, oh, wow, I can't believe that she wants to go. And so, you know, I was going to bring her up, and she was walking with me. And I was thinking, oh, you know, this is great. So we get to the front of the doors, and then she just stops, and she goes, oh, no, I'm not going in there. And she kind of, she walked back, and she kind of ran, and that's why I'm like, oh, there was no way she was going in there. So I just sat with her. So later, when her parents came and picked her up, I told her mom, I said, you know what, we were so close. Like, she like stepped her foot in the door. Her mom said, when I saw the kids walking up there, she's like, I was just looking around. She said, that would have been like a Christmas miracle for me, if I would have seen my daughter walk across. And I was thinking, like, something that me as a mom, like, I just take that for granted. And it's like, this would have made, like, her life if she would have seen her daughter just walk across the stage. And I was like, oh, my gosh, too bad we couldn't get her to do that. So I just tell you that just to keep in mind that little accomplishments are huge to these moms and dads. So
the other sort of story from that was, if you were there that day, the little girl I took up ran on stage, and I went on stage with her and was worried I wouldn't get her off stage.
She kind of plopped out.
Yeah, so, and that is an example of things go wrong, no big deal. Like, you know, we're everyone's there to support you, and it'll all work out. So.
Yeah. Yeah.
I thought, oh great, I'm going to be on stage the entire hour. Which it could happen with the women's care.
Yeah. So any questions? Yeah.
I have a question, and I'll suggest a book.
Yes.
Dancing with Max. And it's Charles Colson's daughter. Her son is autistic. And it's her story. Once they found out he was autistic, the father left. And I do a lot of praying for kids that I get through different internet sites like Caring Bridge. You'd be amazed at how many single mothers are dealing
with
this.
Oh, yes.
where the fathers just can't do it and walk out.
Yes, we...
And those little things you talk about.
Oh, yeah.
Every day. Brian moved his arm.
Right.
You know, and it's like a miracle.
Yeah, yeah. We had a mom in this church for many years who had not one, but two very, very, very involved special needs boys.
Yeah, I'm praying for one now. She's got two and no father around.
No father around. And again, these were the kids that Michelle and I would leave, and we would be like, I mean, we were physically exhausted. And I was like, how does she do this?
And not only do they have to deal with children, they have to deal with the bureaucracy and what's going on with insurance companies.
Yeah.
$8,000 for a wheelchair.
Right.
You know, and here's a mom wondering, where am I going to get $8,000
for
a wheelchair?
That's for sure. So yeah, I could definitely say working in the industry that I work in, it really keeps me grounded. I'm like, thank God that I've got four healthy kids that I don't have to, I don't know how they do it. I really don't. God bless them. But so any other questions? Yeah.
Is the hope to keep the sibling and the VIP together?
No.
Or like, do you want them separate?
No. No.
They want to be together?
However, if one of them is having a difficult time and is wanting the sibling, and I think that's a great example, that great idea that you gave with, you know, there's going to be a 12 on Joey's name tag, and we can track down sibling with the 12, and maybe that just seeing the sibling for a while or doing an activity together would be beneficial. But if that's needed, absolutely. We want to be adaptable and we want to get the best of it. But from my experience, the siblings just kind of want their own time.
Right.
I even had siblings of kids that I've worked with say, so-and-so was so lucky that she has Down syndrome because she gets all the attention and all the, you know. So I think that, it, like Michelle said, it's equally important to the siblings and show them a good time and make it special for them. Yes?
How common is like separation anxiety or having a child that really doesn't want to be there?
That's all on the forums as well. And so I just last week I interviewed a new mom and asked about that. This new mom hasn't ever left her son except for starting an early childhood program. So like in that case, that could be an issue. So it's going to just be individualized, I think, depending on the child and the family and how much the child has been without their parents. So that could be an issue.
Because especially the kids that we don't know.
Right.
We don't know any of that, but we can say in our classroom, that go here, they'll be totally great.
But again, they'll be on the form, and we'll do our best to try to support people in the transition to separation. That's a great question.
Do you try to keep the same buddies and VIPs together from month to month, or do you mix it up?
Well, this is going to be our first one. So, I mean, I think if that is, obviously, if it's something that you had such a great experience with, I think it would be good for the kid to have the same one. Obviously, if it's a child that was really difficult, you know, we can always switch it up. But that would be a great thing, I think. I think even in our classroom, we started doing something new where we try to have the same helper with the child, and it really is helpful. Yeah.
I just back to the siblings, my grandson has special needs, and my daughter was at a seminar where the woman leading the seminar said, if you have a child in your home who has special needs, every child in your home has special needs.
Yes. Yeah. That's true. You can't just go to a restaurant. You can't just take a family vacation. There's so much that is involved in that. So that's definitely true.
Plus, a lot of times the child that doesn't have special needs feels like they're being left out.
Right, right.
Because
absolutely.
So much attention is being spent.
Yep. Anything else? Yeah.
Do you have any idea as to the number of VIPs and siblings that will be attending?
We have, right now, for sure, we have 15 VIPs with
10 siblings.
With 10 siblings, but we definitely are thinking we're going to be having some more be tripling in.
Right. And also, we did want the first one is supposed to be a soft opening. So we didn't want to have all of a sudden, you know, 30 VIPs, you know, where we don't, it'd be a little overwhelming. So that if we have one that's successful with 15 VIPs, then the next month, maybe a few more would be added, and then a few more added each month. So we have 15 VIPs right now. And I think, ironically, kids from our classroom, a lot of them couldn't come. I mean, February 15th couldn't come. So the majority of those are not kids from our classroom. So they're new families.
Which is good, because our hope is that we want to expand our Masterpiece Ministry program. And we want to get more kids in. So we're hoping that this is going to be a positive thing for these parents. And say, oh, well, maybe I'll start coming to church on Sunday here. And they offer this for my child. So, yes.
How many do you have now?
Well, you know, we have a range between anywhere from like 6, 7, sometimes 8. Yeah. And we try to, we've done something new this year too, where we're trying to integrate them in their class with their typical peers as much as possible. So that's been going pretty good.
Yeah. Some children like to draw, if they want to bring their own things, I would assume that would be fine if they
have
a craft environment.
Yeah, I think that would be great. Okay. Yeah, I'm sure there's going to be moms that are going to give you like a little backpack of essentials, and that might be like, we've got a kid that always has their iPad with them. And that could be a great diversion too. It's like, okay, they want to sit on the floor and play with the iPad for 20 minutes to avoid meltdown, have at it. We've got kids that have their own little like communication board, you know, and if that's something that mom can kind of give a little 5-minute tutorial to you how to use it.
With the numbers of VIPs, another thing is we might not need everyone for the first buddy break. We will, I mean, once you start adding it up though, it does add up, because if you have 15 VIPs and 10 siblings, 25, so we need 25 buddies, and then we need people in each of the room, you know, so it does add up. But once you're trained, and so then, you know, if we get more the next month, and then, you know, then we'll put dates out, and our goal is eventually to, when families start in the fall, to say, here's the buddy breaks all year. So people will know, these are the dates all year, people can sign up from the church for certain dates, and the families can sign up, and it'll just be like a rolling, continuing process. Any other questions?
No.
When I went online and did the thing, you had to pick like where you prefer to serve as a buddy break helper or whatever, buddy break person. Does that mean that now if I do the training, I can go to other places or no?
At other churches? Yes.
Yeah. Like, are we able to sign up and serve?
It works for the kids.
Yes. Yes. Although I think right now I don't think there's a close by church.
So we're kind of groundbreaking here.
College church.
College church? Yeah. I'm not sure.
Yeah, I think one of them overall.
Yeah. Okay.
Because you can go on the Buddy Break website and put in your zip code, and they'll tell you where they are around.
Okay. Yeah, the same things are with the kids. The kids that sign up in Wheaton can also come to this church and do it.
Right. So we can not only serve here, we can
Right.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah.
Before, is there any other questions?
Oh, did we talk about t-shirts?
No.
There are samples of t-shirts back there.
I think they all signed it.
I only had 2 pages signed with t-shirt sizes. I have 3 more pages that need to put t-shirt sizes.
Because we're ordering everybody a t-shirt, so we'll know who the buddies are for buddy break.
I'll put these back over there.
If you didn't put your t-shirt size on a form when you leave, look at the form and just think through your t-shirt size. We have some paperwork that Michelle's going to go over, but we thought, we forgot to open in prayer, so we're going to have Andrea close us in prayer. So we'll close in prayer, but then we'll do paperwork. But then that way, when people are done with the paperwork, they can leave. So we'll sort of have a prayer, and then we'll have Michelle talk about paperwork, and then you can stay, and we'll walk around and help everybody with paperwork. But then when you're done with paperwork, you can...
And then on the back long tables, there's like a white sheet of paper on a colored piece of paper, and that just again specifies where your preference is to serve. So if it's a VIP buddy or a sibling buddy, or if you want to be activity helper. So if you could just jot your name down, and then I'll contact you with, you know, further details about what that day looks
like. And if you don't have a preference, which last training some people did have preferences, and you don't have to put your name down, and we know you're open to serving wherever if you don't have a preference. If you have a preference, then you want to sign those.
Okay. Dear Lord Jesus, we thank you so much for all of these willing hearts that are here today, Lord. We know how much you love children, and we know through your word how many miracles that you performed for children, or for people that had disabilities. So we know that this is near and dear to your heart, and we thank you, Lord, for making us successful in attaining all of these willing hearts here, and we thank you for answering our prayers for the VIPs, and we just pray for your guidance through this process and to bring us more and to make this a place that these kids are going to want to go to every month. In your name, amen.
So Michelle, you want to talk about paperwork?
Okay, so there is some paperwork on some of the tables. Some of you may have gone online and filled out the buddy application online, so if you did that, you don't need to fill out another one. There's also a buddy covenant, which is in the book, but I printed out extra ones. I do need these signed. And then there's a background check that will need to be done, and anyone who hasn't had a background check through the church, I'm going to pass these out. So if you want to raise your hand, and minors have to do this one. So if you're under 18, you have to have a green form. Under 18.
No.
And if these can be, any paperwork needs to be turned in tonight or by Friday to the church office.
By Sunday, if they come to church on Sunday, it's fine.
Okay.
Sorry, I have time to do my things.